exclusivity, how that does help your perception of value. So there's two different exclusives that you could potentially use. There's a time constraint and there's quantity. So McDonald's does a phenomenal job with time constraints and the McRib sandwich, right? I drove past a McDonald's not too long ago, and it was like last days for the McRib, right? I don't know why, what the obsession is about this particular sandwich, but something tells me because they take it on and off the menu, and once it's gone for months, makes this freaking sandwich so damn popular.
Yeah. Yeah. Nike's had a phenomenal year, especially as they've been doing more and more of that exact same strategy. Just like, yeah, you know, with the sneakers app and everything they've been doing, it's we have these really ultra limited releases. We have shoes you can buy any time of day, any time of year, you know, but we have these few flagship things that we do that are really exclusive. And again, you don't have to choose to only do the McRib. Again, like, it's like, there's a way to think about this as like tiered offerings, you know, yeah. like, I mean, cars do this a lot too. Like Acura makes the NSX so that everything else in the line feels faster, you know, like, right. It's why every luxury car brand makes a supercar or makes a model that like most people couldn't afford, but also like you don't need all that stuff. But the fact that they have that technology and that they're, you know, you might really like that one thing as like a proof of like, oh, cool. So this proves out what, you know, the more broad thing that I offer or want to be a part of, you know, and it's a good way for personal brands to think about that too. Maybe exclusivity. I thought you were going a different direction with exclusivity. This is an interesting one.
Yeah. So there's time constraints that we just mentioned. So this product or service is only available for X amount of time. So get it now. But then there's quantity, you know, and I use this one. I use this one as well. We only work with 12 clients. I was doing the math. Like over the past 36 months, we've only worked with about 30 clients. So, and that seems to be our real sweet spot, like 10 to 12 clients at max per year is our sweet spot. And we don't really want to do more than that because I'm a huge quality over quantity guy. So I tell people straight up, like I take about 2 clients a month at max. So if you need time to think about it, and it's not bullshit, I really don't. Like, I don't want to take on more than that because I have a quality of life that I like and I don't want to disrupt that. I also know what my bandwidth is and I don't want to go over it. It's just a personal preference. But what I found, where we do our best work is in that quantity of client per year. So I'm sticking to it. I'm sticking to it. I have another quote here from Seth Godin that I just want to throw in here. He says, social proof among the wealthy is based on beauty plus scarcity plus expense.
If you completely oversell what it is you offer and what it is you do, nothing is going to hurt you worse than a great marketing plan. You know, Groupon is a great example of how many businesses Groupon's killed.
Yeah.
So many businesses go way back when, like, would go on Groupon, they'd get a huge influx of customers, can't take those people on. And so they just get review bombed into like one or half star reviews, but it's like they could be really great places. They just get inundated, you know, with like a million people went and got a coupon that they thought would be what you call like a loss leader. Which yeah. is, you know, it's a product you take a hit on because you're like, cool, like if I sell something I am negative on that, then, you know, you're going to buy these other 3 things with it. And the net effective of it will be a win. It's like, cool. But again, like if you get there, like, because the whole point is people talk. Your brand, you do not own your narrative. You can control it. You can help shape it and define it. That's why I talk about things like North Star and like, you know, trajectory. I use words that are like wayfinding when I think of brand, because it really is, you're steering a ship. But ultimately, there's external factors that you don't control. A brand is a conversation that's had inside and outside of your business.